their regrets. On behalf of the Research Office and the Fine Arts Program here at STU, let me say, well, please, Diane, if you are here to join us for today's book launch, As I See It by Raymond Brayton. I should remind you that there are copies of the book available in the back. There are also refreshments available, so please do not be shy. In a minute or so, I'm going to turn things over to Liam Forstall, and I'll let him tell you more about this exciting project. It will be followed by Tony Tremblay and then by Raymond Fraser himself. But before I do, I just want to make a few very brief comments. First of all, I would like to publicly thank the Department of Post-Secondary Training and Labor for the annual financial contribution that the department makes to the running of our research office. It was funds from this source that we were able to provide to William to inform us about this exciting project that brings together STU students with artists from outside the academy. Second, let me emphasize that the research office is increasingly focused on trying to find innovative ways to link student research and creative endeavors with those of our faculty members. And the goal here is not to try to micromanage the relationships between students and faculty, but to seek out helpful ways that allow student interests and faculty interests to feed off one another, while at the same time ensuring that both groups maintain a fair amount of autonomy in their individual intellectual pursuits. So if you have ideas or views in terms of what you think might help us in this endeavor, please, again, don't be shy to knock on our doors and send us an email, stop in the hallway, share your ideas. And then finally, given the student-focused element of today's gathering, I'd be remiss if I did not remind you that the university's Student Research and Ideas Fair will be held on March the 16th, and the deadline for submitting proposals is fast approaching on February the 9th. So that's it from me. Please join me in welcoming William Forstall.
All right, thank you very much, Michael. Wonderful introduction to the before I get too far down the road, I would like to thank a few people. Michael, thank you very much. Thank you for the support of the project as well. It's very interesting. And so far, so good. We pulled it off. I told my students that this, all these projects are somewhat high risk. They can fail. This one has succeeded. Thanks to Michael, thanks to Raymond Fraser. Get back to you. Tony Tremblay, thank you very much for looking forward. Anna Kirsted is not here, but is the designer and worked with the students on the project. Fine Arts Department, Frank Janowski, Robin Peck for their support, and of course, the students of FNAR 1113, who actually wound up doing most of the work. They're the ones who took the photographs, they're the ones who actually selected the poems and that way edited. They're the ones who took the photographs or interpreted the poems in their own way. And from there, a lot of other work went into it. Working with the designer, working with Raymond, coming to the classroom, organizing this whole thing, and eventually, of course, getting a publication out of it. So it's really has, all these ideas have little inception points. And I don't know where the inception point was, but it was probably on a summer walk, bumping into Raymond Fraser, and part of a larger community. We started talking about things, and possible projects, and poetry, and visual arts, and how they could be brought together. And of course, bringing them together with students, because I'm an artist, I paint things. When I started teaching here, of course, I realized the great potential of bringing more artists and relationships with institutional structures like St. Thomas University and the student body. And that's kind of always turned out okay this time. And we're working on a few other projects, working with a couple of other visual artists. And we'll keep our fingers crossed on that. But for now, I'd like to say thank you very, very much to everyone who showed up today. And I'd also like to introduce you, Tony Tremblay.
Thank you, Will. Just a very short and brief few remarks I want to make here. The first is just to extend my congratulations to you and to your students, Will, for a very fine job. This is a unique project in many ways. It certainly extends the bounds of what we consider to be normal pedagogy in the teaching of English, and specifically the teaching of poetry. And there's a real engagement in this project, which puts Ray's poetry up against students' capacity to creatively interpret that poetry in terms of visual imagery. So it's very, from my point of view, very impressive what the result or what the outcome has been. And it models what I think of as the ideal reading practice, and that is that it's a kind of relationship between an author, poet, and a reader, student. And the result, of course, is a kind of shared responsibility for the interpretation and the sustaining and extension of the work of art. And we certainly see that in this collection. So my hearty congratulations to all of you who are involved. And I'm not surprised to hear Mike Dawson say that this is an area of interest that the research office is pursuing, because things like this are possible at a university like ours, which is open to liberal arts ideas and open to creative ways of doing things that we do. And kind of most of us, I'm calling attention to myself here, do in stuffy old ways. So this is a really innovative project. I'm delighted to contribute to it in a small way. It's my pleasure as well to introduce Brendan Fraser. I've known Ray specifically through his work for 30 years. I've been reading his work for 30 years, and I've often thought that Ray is one of our finest New Brunswick writers, and I still hold that position. Ray is a fiction writer, a novelist. He's written memoirs and biographies. He's been a practicing journalist. And last but not least, he's been, I think, a very accomplished poet. Perhaps Ray will accept the least credit for his poetry. I'm not sure that you think of yourself predominantly as a poet, Ray. My sense from our discussions and the critical work that I've read on you is that you consider yourself more a fiction writer than a poet. Maybe it's just me, the critic, who makes that subtle kind of distinction. However, the reason I bring it up is because I think your poetry is just as exceptional as your fiction in terms of delivering a succinct and subtle portrait of what it means to live in this place at this time. I've never read a Ray Fraser poem that didn't work for me. And I teach Ray's fiction and poetry in a classroom here at St. Thomas University. And I've never had a student who's read a Ray Fraser poem or story, they didn't immediately fall in love with them. So your poetry is as appreciated by students as Ray as your fiction is. Lastly, by way of introduction, I think it's important for me to say that the real strength of Ray's work is that he raises his characters to a level that we don't normally see them raised. Ray's been a pioneer in Canada in offering his characters a kind of literary citizenship. So his characters are not bankers, they're not wealthy, they're not famous, they don't have aristocratic bearing. They're average folks that we all know. They drive backhoes and they pick their girlfriends up in the schoolyard after school, and they sit on park benches. And they worry, and they plan for the future, and they fail. And as a result, they're incredibly familiar to us. And what my students say back to me consistently about Ray's work is that they've never read a Ray Fraser story or a Ray Fraser poem without recognizing the characters in it. And that's no small accomplishment and not easy to do. So I think that's particularly significant, right? So, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the poet of concern, Brendan Fraser.
Thanks, Tommy. I really enjoyed all of those good things you said about me. Not true. No, I especially appreciate that the students do. the way he was saying about how this got started, this book is quite true. He would be out walking his dog on the trail, and I would be out walking up and walk myself. And just seemed to run into each other very frequently. And we did be talking about this project. And first it was not too well defined, and gradually, the more we ran into each other, the closer we got to what it was going to be about. And once that was decided from there, he took it and, you know, did all the work. He had the students, and my job was to provide the poems. I had an 82-poem manuscript that I just put together, one published poems, and the idea was I'd give that to him and he'd give it to the students, and they would make a selection, each one, and they'd find a photograph that would match up with the poem. Must have been quite a lot of work, so they all wouldn't pick the same poem or whatever, so they get that number around to them. But it worked out just fine. Very, very nice production, and got a lot of compliments on it from the people who read it so far. I'm going to read a few poems from there. This one's called One-Legged Pigeon. I like that poem. I don't know anybody else would, but obviously the person, the girl picked it up, she must have liked it. A one-legged pigeon swells its neck and puffs its feathers, goes hobbling around in clumsy circles, while a female pigeon across the park ignores him, pecking the ground. It's his mating dance. The one-legged lonesome pigeon shuffle. Closer he dances, and a little closer. To seeing him, she shakes her feathered locks, and with a scornful look, takes wing and flies away. He pauses, glancing skyward, watches till she's gone. Then in solitude resumes a while, stumbling pirouettes, shoulders sagging, softly cooing, the sad-eyed strains of the lonesome, one-legged pigeon blues. The young lady who took got the picture for that said she searched all over Fredericton and couldn't find the pigeon. maybe she had a one-legged pigeon. They're hard to find. Anyway, she improvised, and as you will see, those who have the book will see that. This next one is the Ice Cream Parlor Reunion. I put a date on 1980, not because I wrote it in 1980, but because that's when it's more than supposedly takes place. Actually, it did. It's based on a true thing. And sometimes in the poem, I will put a date in the title, so it refers to that. But it may have been written yesterday, for that matter, even though it would say 1980 in the title. Others sometimes I put at the bottom, and that will be definitely telling you when I wrote it. Okay. This is called Ice Cream Parlor Reunion. She had an eye like a hawk, knew the minute I walked in the door. Oh no. That oh no, oh God, look, the tone. That I knew so well 20 years before. All those years and nothing changed. On the phone I suggested we meet in a bar. She countered with an ice cream parlor. But I don't eat ice cream, I protested, and an ice cream parlor it was. I'm afraid I failed her, dispelled her housewife's fantasy, didn't rematerialize as Prince Charming, driving up in my Jaguar, wearing $5,000 worth of casual sportswear. I was still me, long-haired and hairy-faced, in a $10 corduroy jacket, and blue jeans and cowboy boots, and the long-suffering, oh God, drunk of course, goodbye sweet dreams. She in her suburban finery, straight from the hairdresser, polished and shining. My sweet dreams shot to hell as well. No long straight hair down her back, no jeans and party-colored poncho, no bangles and no beads, all those years. Next one, it's a lady in Kevin, she's a Florida shell. She's from New Brunswick, lived in Florida, retired, and she said this one was her favorite. It's called the census. Now this one has, let me see what I did with these numbers. This says Chad 1961, that means I wrote it in 1961. However, I have a lot of poems, big thick file of poems that I've done over the years and haven't looked at and haven't published or collected. And every now and then I'll take some of these out and go over them and revise them, put some work into them and resurrect them. And that's one of them. So, the census. I was home, but nobody came. Nobody at the door with pad and pencil to take my name and ask those questions I heard they asked about where you're working and what you made and what you paid for your apartment. And if you had a toilet, was there hot water in your tap? And what was your nationality? I was going to say occupation poet, income nothing. But nobody came with pad and pencil to take my name. Okay, I want to read the rest of it. It's inside here.
I don't have a favorite poem in this book because I like all Ray Frazier's work. Ray is one of our great writers in the province, and it was my pleasure to write a foreword to this book because of how much I enjoy his work and what I know of as his contribution to the literature of the province. The real accomplishment of this book is the way in which it interprets Ray's poetry. Ray's poetry has been read by a large class of students. Those students have looked at the poems and they've responded with, I think, creative equivalents in photographic form to what the poems themselves in textual form say. So the real accomplishment here in this collection is that it's a shared collaboration toward a kind of meaning making that models what reading really is.
Yeah, no, it's it was a great project. It was wonderful working with Raymond. It was great working with the students. The students were really taking on a lot of responsibility. With, you know, I recognized Raymond's work, and I read his great poem. And there's a lot of trust by Raymond, and there's a lot of responsibility taken, creative responsibility taken by the students. And synthesizing that, and they all took at least 3, 4, 5 photographs. They worked with Raymond one-on-one, selecting the photographs and getting them into a publication. And this is this project did work. Not all projects work out. This was like high risk, but also a good reward at the end of this. And we have a unique visual art project that once again offers a new interpretation of a highly regarded poet's work. And students got to see how a project works and how the creative community works. That interchange between different levels of creativity weaving together to come up with a finalized product.